All right.
Value.
All right. Well, thank you all very much for coming virtually. Jen said, if you mute your mic, then I won't hear you flush the toilet, and no one else will either. And I also have the chat window open. So if you like, you can just make a note there if you want me to call on you. So please interrupt anytime. And if you want to just yell, obviously unmute yourself and it should pop up in the screen. I should see your face there. So this is some work that I've done with predoctoral fellow at the lab we have here, Scott Viteri. So Scott's lovely. You can see from him being on a segue that he was originally at MIT. He's now doing a PhD in the Stanford CS department. The draft for this paper, I put this on the Slack channel, if you were on the Slack channel. I would love comments from folks either during the talk, or you can Slack me or email me afterwards, and we'll use those to make some final passes before putting it up on the archive. Before I talk about the particular chunk of work that we're doing, I should tell you a little bit about where we are as a lab after I've grown up from being a postdoc with the Institute. So we run a little lab here, the Lab for Social Minds. It's not as awesome as James Evans's lab. But we sort of have three pieces that we stick together. And the first one is something that I haven't been able to do, or I wasn't able to do at the Institute, which was start doing lab experiments. So those are both things on Mechanical Turk, but also putting people in groups in person to study behaviors. And the nice thing there is that you get a lot of causal knobs to turn. So you can flip switches and see how people think. The problem with lab experiments, and this is something that I saw really early on, is that very often these are low stakes environments. So, you know, you can make $5, $10, $20 on them. But the IRB, in fact, you know, asks you to set things up so that they're not in any way high stakes. So what we do is try and combine that with some work in data science. And so this is something that we got very good at over the years. Which is trying to figure out, okay, if you have some theories about how people think in the lab, do they show up at all when you go into the real world? And in particular, when you try and examine behaviors associated with really high stakes situations. So the case you have on your screen there is from the French Revolution, right? So you have a theory about how people respond to novelty in the lab, whether they pick this song or that song to listen to. Then you go into the archives and say, okay, well, how do people respond to novelty when it's a question of, you know, should you run the country this way or that way? Finally, the other piece, and this is partly something we've started doing because we get access to all of the gurus in machine learning at CMU, is play around with the fact that deep learning, neural networks, finally, this is, we all know this since around 2010 in the GPU era, neural networks have done extraordinarily well and replicating human-like behavior. And one of our goals is to figure out exactly how they work, and with the hope that, in fact, that might tell us something about human about how human cognition works. So this has been a great success in our studies of the visual system. We get the same kinds of edge detectors out of a neural network that we get out of a, you know, sticking pins into a cat and watching the neural responses there. So the hope is that maybe some of the higher level cognitive functions might also be things that we can understand. If a deep learning network is good at writing a story, maybe there's some stuff about stories that is relevant to the human case as well. We're interested also in cross-domain preferences. And in particular, one of the things that we'll talk about today is the use of reason and the use of explanation. So here's an example. This is one of my students in, actually my graduate seminar, Jin Woo Kim, who's in marketing at Tepper, the business school. And we've been interested in the question of how people explain things. I don't just, you know, try to predict what's going on. I don't just react to what's going on, but I also want some story about what's going on. It's not enough for me to figure out, okay, is Jeffrey gonna fall asleep or not? But I also want some explanation as to why Jeffrey's gonna fall asleep. Jin Woo looked into this, and one of the things we're wondering is whether or not we could see explanatory preferences. So the idea that somebody adopts one kind of explanation in preference to another, that are potentially equally predictive, if a person shows a preference for one over the other, does that preference generalize? So we looked back into the literature. Actually, one of the great chunks of literature on this is from Theodore Adorno. Adorno's claim is that a big difference between left-wing and right-wing people, and by right-wing here, he means like the Nazis, is a preference for systemic versus individual level explanations. So the idea is lefties like system level explanations. People on the right wing perhaps prefer explanations that focus on individuals, individual people, and potentially our hope was, or our interest is, even individual objects. So here's two examples that Jim Wu tested in the lab. We give people, these are called scenario studies. Scenario studies very limited, of course, because we're asking people to imagine, so we're simultaneously testing their imaginations. They're also low stakes, but anyway, we rely on people's goodwill to do a good job on this. He'll provide a thing that happened and then tries to figure out people's preferences for how to explain it. So here's one, an Uber driver arrives late. Your Uber driver arrives late. Is it due to bad traffic conditions or bad decisions made by the driver? So A is a systemic explanation, B is an individual level one. Strong preferences there for if you are a right-wing person to prefer B, the individual level explanation. If you're a lefty, you prefer A. In fact, this correlates with something called social dominance orientation. So it's not free market preferences that do this, but what's called SDO. SDO is like the dark chunk of the right wing, right? That's the Nazi stuff. We were keen to see if that same explanatory preference, A versus B, would generalize to a completely non-political situation. You might say, okay, you're gonna blame somebody, or you're gonna blame, that may still be political. So then we also fed people questions like this: a chemist heats a sample of a new substance. Is it due to systemic features of the compound or a flaw in that particular sample? So we're interested in sort of, you might say, the deep structure of how people think and perceive the world. This goes against the current trend in behavioral science that I would say is basically evo psych plus Richard Dawkins. I read Selfish Gene 20 years ago, and I'm still rolling it out. So here is the best and brightest from social behavioral science. They put this paper out a few days ago. How the gurus of this world can help support the COVID pandemic response. I'm just going to pull out one example here. The best behavioral science says that what we should do is have celebrities model pro-social behavior, and this will lead to a contagion effect. I think this is absurd, honestly. I think it's absurd. We would immediately see it was absurd if we applied it to ourselves. So if I said, okay, whatever, the 35 people in this room, you're not behaving well, you're still going to the Institute, you're really, you're behaving poorly, but look, it's a video of, Michelle Pfeiffer not doing this, and that's going to have the big contagion effect. I think you'd all, first of all, laugh, and second of all, you might be insulted if I persisted. We underestimate, I would say, the extent to which quote-unquote ordinary people use reasons and use the deep chunks of their brain to actually make high stakes decisions. So, here's the standard story, right? There's a bunch of memes floating around. These are behaviors we imitate. Dan, who visited us at the Institute for a while, loves memes, fine, Dan's great. People are like, what's a meme? Dan's like, well, here, a word is a meme you can pronounce. So these little kind of units that you propagate around. This is not actually how culture works. It's not, that kind of sharing. Maybe it happens a little bit, like, I don't know, we're all, smoking a pipe now, great. But by and large, the reason we adopt behaviors and beliefs is because we reason. One way we know that is, okay, let's take, this is, David has seen this picture. I don't know if he's online right now. I learned a lot from David, right? David teaches me things. I'll sit in a talk by David, I'll listen to what he's saying, I'll absorb it, he will have transmitted a lot of stuff to me. But one thing's for sure is that I will never actually repeat anything he says verbatim. I will never repeat a single sentence that he says. Not only that, he may very well transmit his ideas to me and we'll find ourselves in deep disagreement. So he will have had a direct influence on my cognition, even without passing on any of the surface features. Another way, I mean, that's the kind of intuitive sense. You like, let's just introspect for a while on that. I learned this from David Krakauer years ago. I think it was one of his summer school talks. We know in biology of what's called the error catastrophe, right? When mutation rates get too high, you can no longer sustain a quasi-species, right? The thing just spreads out over all of genotype space. It's a critical transition. It happens at one mutation per base pair. The mutation rate, such as it is from David to me, is near unity, right? If you, again, look at the surface level, David and I will never write the same paper. We'll probably not really come to the same conclusions unless, in fact, we interact over again. So the very fact that we have culture argues against these kind of, you know, the fast side of the thinking fast and slow story. I was really influenced by Helena Mitton when she came to visit us at Carnegie Mellon before she took the postdoc with you guys. This is a book that just came out maybe a few years ago, which I highly recommend reading. This is Hugo Mercier and Dan Sperber. This book is about the role of reasoning, and I would say it's a bit of an antidote to the thinking fast and slow literature. There's obviously, we made a great deal of progress understanding fast thinking, right? These kind of intuitive ways we blow like the Wason selection task, let's say. You know, the way in which we, you know, can't figure out how much the baseball bat costs. Melanie, I agree, The Enigma of Reasoning should definitely be the next SFI book club. So for Mercier and Sperber, like, they're not saying we are reasoning machines in the sense that we form our beliefs on the basis of reason. They're certainly in favor of, you know, non-introspectable modules, and, you know, were we able to even introspect on those modules, they'd look disastrous from the point of view of any kind of normative, let's say, philosophical stance on reasoning. But they emphasize the role of post-hoc work in reasoning. The way in which we use logic or justification in a social process. Meaning, in other words, that we may form our ideas for like totally bullshit reasons, or maybe because, you know, we have direct contact with the Platonic forms. We then go out into the world and other people ask us to justify ourselves. It's that justification step that helps us think better. And it's the justification step that's at the heart of, I would say, cultural evolution. So that's my kind of opening plea for how, you know, we at the Institute or of the Institute can think better about cultural evolution. I think we need to go beyond the kind of infection, contagion metaphor and get much better at cognitive science. So, all right, let's talk now about what you all came here to hear about, which is mathematical proofs. So proofs are one of the great inventions of the species. We know, for example, or at least there are many cultures that figured out the Pythagorean theorem. It's really useful for building pyramids. It was the Greeks, however, who decided, at least in the Western tradition, it was the Greeks who decided that it was not enough just to kind of know this. You also had to say, not just, right, here's what we believe, but here's also why we believe it. To justify your belief in a certain kind of statement. Originally, these statements were purely geometric. At some point, we also accepted algebraic statements as things that were worthy of this kind of treatment. I would associate this, since this was a working group we had a few months ago now, before the end of the world, this is the Axial Age moment, at least this was the Axial Age moment for the ancient Greeks, right? It was not a change necessarily in doing or seeing, but a change in justification in the kinds of things that we accepted as reasons to believe, and in particular, in this case, justification with respect to some kind of transcendental or at least normative set of principles. Proofs are great. There's a little fragment. It's, you know, falling apart and moth-eaten, but we've done them for way, way longer than we've done science. So the other claim, I would say, the reason to pay attention to proofs is not just because they're, you know, an interesting example of reason, but they're probably our longest timescale example of a reasoning system that's by and large mostly stable. So, you know, we did this, here's the famous proof of Fermat's Last Theorem from 1995, and actually we'll examine some of that structure as well. So proofs are, 400 BC was 30 years after the plague of Athens. Thank you, Stefan. All right. So there's a paradox that sits at the heart of mathematical proofs. I would say it also sits at the heart of most kinds of justification. So when you ask me to, I'm like, hey, I'm quarantining at home. Why are you quarantining at home? Because I'm afraid of this disease. Why are you afraid of this disease? As you ask me to provide further and further justifications, my set of reasons, my logic, the way things are connected together, gets larger and larger. And as it gets larger and larger, we tend to think that makes it more and more secure, right? If I'm able to expand my reasoning further, that should increase your confidence in what I'm doing, as opposed to saying like, I don't know, it's just a gut, right? The paradox of an expanded set of reasons being taken more seriously, or expanding set of reasoning steps being taken more seriously. Here's what math looks like to me on my screen here. The paradox of that is that any error, right? If you're a hardcore mathematician, right? Any error in that series invalidates the proof, right? There's a mistake in your reasoning. The longer the proof, right? The errors, at least on a really simple model of the errors happening independently, like, Homer nods, I was not paying attention at that moment, it just compounds exponentially. So the confidence you ought to have in a proof should decline extraordinarily rapidly. That's your chance of making an error epsilon. That's your normative belief that the proof is correct. The time scale for decay into just complete rubbish and bullshit is, if you have an error rate of 1 in 100, it's about 100 steps. An error rate of 1 in 1,000, it's 1,000 steps. Let me give you 1,000 logic problems in a row. How well do you think you can do? Do you think you can really do 1,000 of them without making an error? I doubt it. So somewhere between 100 and 1,000 steps is where you should really just stop believing proofs altogether. One answer to this is that, hey, mathematicians are actually really good. They're better than us. They have some magic ability to reason correctly, to keep all these little bits and pieces in their heads. Here is Poincaré. These are not hard to find. Basically, the better the mathematician, the more likely they are to say this sort of stuff. Henri Poincaré, I'm absolutely incapable of adding without mistakes. So mathematicians, under some very simple story about why you ought to believe mathematical proofs, you ought not to believe them, right? If you ought to believe a proof because it is a series of deductive steps, then you ought not to believe it because the chance that somebody's made an error in that sequence is extraordinarily high. It's basically 100% for the length of the proofs that we have in play. And yet, even at the same time, and let's bring a little realism here into the cultural practice, mathematicians themselves do not spend a lot of time obsessing about this problem. In the paper, our line on this is, under the standard philosophical justification, such as given by Poincaré, that's something similar to a neuroscientist, or rather a neurosurgeon, boasting of having a really unsteady hand. Like, it's funny, I'm a great neurosurgeon, but I really can't even successfully stack it. Melanie, this is a simple model that assumes that the statements have independent probabilities of being correct or incorrect. If I'm gonna go be an information theorist, I'll say, instead of taking the literal steps 1, 2, 3, 4, just take the effective number of steps. Hopefully a mathematician is putting in a certain number of bits of information. Each of those bits has a chance of error that again compounds exponentially.
How do you deal with the fact that the proof process is often working through something many times, talking to other people, that there's sort of this, multiple passes through the work itself, that you don't just sit down and sort of write the proof in one go, and if you have an error in there, then it gets published with that error. I mean, there's sort of this self-checking process that goes on, and how do you account for that?
Absolutely. I think there's a really good pair of questions in there, Chris, right? One is, and this is the easy punch, right? Exponentials, as we're being lectured on right now, are really extraordinarily powerful. If you, and I'll show you some examples, if you expand the logical reasoning here out for any normal proof, you expand it down to the normative level, it's hundreds of thousands of steps, right? So you know, you need the error rate, whether it's collective or individual, to be, I would say, implausibly low. The other thing I would say, and this is like the flip side, what we might want out of this is, somebody has their mic unmuted, I will just say, so we can hear.
So something. That's Jessica. I don't know who that Jessica is, but Jessica, you need to turn your microphone off, please. Thank you.
All right, very good. Thank you. But fast typing. So, you know, Chris, what I would say maybe as a follow-up is that one thing we might want is a story about how mathematicians zoom in on some particular subset of the problem for double-checking. I don't have an answer to that, but that would be the other response is, yes, that's probably a big chunk of it, the social proof of the proof. But I think we still have a gap here. By the way, this argument goes back to Hume. It's the third of his skeptical arguments, and this is the argument against logical reason. So, you can find the citation in the paper. All right, so the first thing is, the first sort of step beyond this paradox to try and resolve it is the fact that this linear chain is not actually how proofs work. There's lots and lots of reuse. So here is Euclid's geometry. Each of these nodes is a proposition in the geometry, and Euclid, of course, being sort of the paradigm of how proofs ought to work. You know, he lays everything out extraordinarily explicitly, constantly referring to the axioms he needs. So we get a really big, full picture of what's going on. You can see most of these nodes have multiple links going not just in, meaning the things that they need for their support, but also going out, meaning the different things that they're doing. If you think of a proof network, it's not a deep learning system. Things are getting reused at multiple levels over and over again. So one answer is that, you know, the chain might not be 100,000 steps. Any particular path here may be actually much, much shorter. When we came to ask these questions about how proofs worked, you know, we got Euclid. I'll show you another example. We have Spinoza, we have Apollonius. If you're a St. John's person, you know Apollonius, we get the word through him. Those are really explicitly justified things where each of those people felt that they were in the business of making sure that everything was cited.
Simon, so, what do the different colors mean?
The colors there are Luban clusters. David says, what is a node and what is an edge here? So the nodes in this picture are propositions in Euclid. So one of these is going to be the parallel postulate. That's an axiom sitting somewhere. I forget where it is. Let me move my mouse over. I can't see my mouse. Where is it? Okay, I can't do my mouse. So you'll have some axioms there. Those have only ingoing node arrows, ingoing in this case because these are dependency relations. Other nodes sitting in there will be things like, I don't know, the Pythagorean theorem or theorems on commensurability of integers of the infinity of primes. So these are just Luban clusters. So we wanted to go, I mean, that's great. We can, you know, put these up, lots and lots of fun. There's only three of them. Scott, being the kind of guru he is and having great taste in the future of mathematics, brought to us the idea of using automated proof assistance. So this is a hot topic. Everybody loves it or hates it. It's come to maturity now, meaning that real, quote unquote, real mathematicians are using automated proof assistance to prove things, find gaps in their own claims. Automated proof assistant, we're using something called Cox, C-O-Q, named after one of the people who was involved in its development. He's French, so, you know, Cox, we gotta call it Cox. Here's a screenshot of what it looks like. What you do as a mathematician using Cox is you kind of sketch out the proof, and the proof assistant fills in the gaps. So I didn't understand this. I Scott helped me understand this by showing me a proof that 4 is even. So here's how it goes. And this is even a sketch on top of a sketch. There's 27 nodes in this proof. So, okay, 0 is a number, that's a claim. Successor on a number is a number, that's a claim. 0 is even, that's a claim. A number that's the successor of a successor is an even claim. Okay, those are all axioms going into the system. Now you've got some lemmas, the sum of two even numbers is even. And then, okay, how do you prove that? Out the other side, you get a chunk of computer code, actually, and if the code compiles, you have proved the theorem. So this relies on something called a type theoretic approach to mathematics, in contrast to a set theoretic approach. The type theoretic approach like Bertrand Russell and Alfred North Whitehead had to invent when Gödel showed up and, you know, well, when people showed up and showed them the paradox of the barber. You know, the story is that, you know, they didn't actually quit trying to axiomatize mathematics, they kept going. And in doing so, they invented this thing called type theory. Type theory is the really simple version is that everything is a type, literally in the sense that a computer program, you've got things that are of type string and type integer, and you can't add a string to an integer without something going wrong. Type theory reduces the problem of mathematics to the problem of making sure that you don't screw up your types. Fun things about type theory, proving something is simply showing or demonstrating the existence of an object of type proof of the thing you want to show. You'll see here the example of this lemma. Once you prove that lemma is itself an object in type theory. It's an object of type proof that two numbers, the sum of two even numbers is even. So we had a lot of fun with this. We spent like a year hacking this apart. I should put that up there. This is a little bit more on what the source code looks like for the proof that four is even. The magic of something like Koch is that it uses tactics. These are just heuristics that the machine uses. Try and fill in the gaps in the proof. So if you look at that chunk of code there, don't like try and figure it out. I still can't work it out. But there's little commands in there that are actually calls to the underlying proof assistant to say, okay, look, the guy wants to do this, you know, help her out. Right? This is the exact parallel to the Euclidean geometry or to Euclid's geometry. Each of those nodes there is a part of the proof that four is even. So a big task for us, you know, it was not as hardcore as Stephanie simulating all of Australasia. A big task for us was, pausing Koch right when it had constructed this tree, but before it tried to compile it. That tree is a tree. We then have to unify it, finding the claims that can be identified in different chunks of the reasoning. So this is our best approximation to the true underlying structure. That's the proof that four is even. The automated proof assistant gang has gone to, it has done this for many, many things. Here's Gödel's incompleteness there. So this is the underlying logical structure of, don't ask me to recite Gödel's incompleteness theorem. I guess you read Doug Hofstadter's book. This is the underlying logical structure. The colors are Luban clusters. Again, the nodes are claims. This is a partial expansion. So we don't go all the way down to the bottom. Thanks, Chris. We don't go all the way down to the bottom of the thing. It just breaks our machine. It gets to the millions and billions of nodes in some cases. This is 28,000 nodes, however. So this is even a coarse-grained version. You'll see some of the nodes are bigger than others. Those are the out degrees, meaning the number of things that node is used by. So you'll note some of the nodes are much bigger than others, and you can probably guess what's coming on that. James asks, what the hell is the Luban clustering algorithm? What this is doing is figuring out, okay, can you find groups of nodes that have lots of connections within that group and fewer connections outside of that group? So a cluster there is defined as things that interrelate to each other much more than they relate to things outside. Luban's a greedy clustering algorithm, I won't go into the detail of how it does it. It relies solely on the topology of the network. So thanks, Chris, for bringing that up.
Simon, do you mind if I ask a question?
Yes, of course, of course.
So one thing that I would say, which is maybe more of a networky point, is that I think often you'll have a bunch of similar lemmas, but which are connected more to the things that use them than they are to each other. And in that case, this type of clustering algorithm would consider them part of the things that are using them, right, rather than part of a kind of similarity community of kind of similar tools that get used in similar places. So that's maybe comment.
That's great, Chris. Yeah, I'm just thinking. I mean, I feel like somebody should invent like a, I don't know, like a, just to make up a term, a stochastic block model to handle exactly this problem. So yes, I will dump this on you. Yes, thank you. It's a wonderful point.
The other thing I would ask you though is, I mean, so certainly when I teach Godel's incompleteness theorem, I'm teaching several concepts, which, you know, of course, as you know, are high level concepts. I'm not breaking them down into anything like elementary axiomatic steps.
Yeah.
Do you think that these clusters or something like them correspond to those high level concepts?
That's a really great question, and I want the answer to that. The problem is that the nodes have very mysterious labels. So when you get the abstract syntax tree, the sort of compiled tree that comes up, that comes out of, let's say, Yak, a lot of that information is lost, unfortunately. I would love to be able to tell you, like if you look at the Euclidean case where that's hand done, you probably saw a cluster that was sitting out on the edge. That's all that number theory stuff. It's great, right? It's just kind of sitting out there. It's clearly a conceptual unity. It's harder for me to figure out what's going on here, but it's not impossible that we could. One way to do it is to trace all the way back to the axiom. So if that purple clump there is relying on a set of axioms from some module, the names of those axioms might help you out. But it's a great question, Chris, absolutely.
Can I just dive in with another related question?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm trying to, so you're using, these kind of like theorem proving checkers, but so Oscar Dijkstra, kind of like famously had this whole approach and critique that, the way in which you actually get to the end of the proof is not the way in which you typically perform the proof. Right. So there's a whole host of neural pathways and, kind of, and not just dead ends, but also, it could be that often, you'll come around in some unusual way to the end of the proof. And then you like clean it up and you make these like very general seeming didactic, steps that make you look like a genius or an impossible thinker. But we're in some sense impossible to have crossed. And so, so it's two things, one is like, what's the discursive performance of the proof? And it's another thing, what's the actual chain of logic which led to the thing, which are almost always very different.
Absolutely. Dead on. What I would say is that this is exactly what we're after. So I'm beginning here to leverage a story about the kinds of things that Dijkstra is talking about. And so, beginning of this talk, why you shouldn't believe the standard story. This part, okay, here's the data. In a second, we're gonna get to, okay, given what the data tells us about the normative structure, the underlying logical structure, does that help us tell a story about cognitively what's actually going on for these guys, right? So, if you will indulge me for a second, because here's your, power, in case you guys felt lonely being quarantined, here's your power law, so it should make you feel part of the great power law community. All of these things happen, it's absolutely delightful. And in the next slide, I'll tell you there's some really fascinating connections to topologies of other kinds of networks. You have an exponential cutoff in dependencies, meaning if you wanna prove something, maybe you need about 10 things coming in, at least at this level of resolution. By the way, that holds roughly speaking for Euclid, the constants, smaller, but not too much smaller. Flip side, the outgoing implications of a theorem have this hardcore power law tail. It really is a power law. Not only is it a power law, but it's really spooky. Every single theorem we tested, both in the human case and in the cock case, has an index of 2 with an error. So it's not just a power law. It's not just that there's stuff sitting out on the extreme, but bizarrely, they're all converging to a power law of index 2. So Sid, you should be really happy because this is your model of assembly and tinkering. So that's the four color theorem and Godel's first incompleteness theorem that you saw. This is the curve for software architecture in open source software. This is Sergey and Ricard. who did some of this work. It's a parallel index of two. They like the cumulative one, whatever, right? It's two and my scaling. Yes, David says, Wolpert says, I'm not fully understanding. In degree is a cutoff, but out degree is a power law. Exactly, David. So, you know, most things or nearly everything, in fact, everything uses just a few things to establish its claim. But there are some of those claims, once established, are used everywhere in the proof. And of course, some of them are things like at the level of expansion. If we go deep enough, some of those will be like zero is a thing. Okay, fine. But that's true at different levels of expansion. So even derived claims, even high level claims have that same property. There are some nodes that have an outsized influence on the rest of the network. This is, Sid worked on this, 15 years ago now. This is a growing network with copying. I get why SFI did this for years, right? It's sitting right at this critical point. When you balance the number of nodes you link to and the probability of linking to them, you enter this marginal state. Roughly speaking, here's how you do it. Here's how you prove something. Here's how you build an open source project. Pick something to use, and then look at the stuff that thing you just picked also used, right? So go backwards and pick some of that stuff with some probability Q. Thank you, Sid. Krepivsky, not Krepivsky. I misspelled the first name of the author there. Thanks, Sid. All right. So yeah, this prediction, if you're at this marginal state, you're gonna get a power law distribution with index two. All this magic happens. Here's the data. You can see the top, we have 50 theorems from Cox, so I don't show them all. There's Euclid, Godel, Bertrand's Ballot, polyhedron formula. I mean, we go down. They're all sitting at two or just a little bit above two. If you stick all of the Cox theorems together, you get a parallel index around 2.1 plus or minus 0.1. This also holds roughly for the four human networks that we have. So Euclid, Apollonius, and Spinoza are all proving stuff that is, that you know, they're doing their best to reference everything all the way back. Spinoza obviously is proving, like, you know, God loves you. He's looking a little different from the mathematicians. The last one there is Andrew Wiles's proof, the 1995 proof of Fermat's Last Theorem. That's an informal network. So I just built that by reading the proof and looking for all the explicit points where Wiles referenced other things. So I just went through page by page. I do not understand Fermat's Last Theorem's proof, right? But you just go and you just kind of look to see where he's saying, oh, because this, because that, that kind of thing.
Simon, can I ask a question?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
So these are all theorems except for Euclid's geometry, which is a collection of theorems?
Yep, yep.
And is that apples and oranges or?
Not really. So we just did Euclid's geometry all at once there, but you can pull out, let's say, Pythagorean theorem, just pull that theorem and shake it out from the rest of the network and do the same analysis, and you'll get the same results. So actually one of the curves I'll show you is for just the Pythagorean theorem in Euclid's geometry. So yeah, I don't know. Is that helpful, Melanie? Great, okay. Oh, you're muted, so I can't hear you. Yes, excellent, thank you. So, all right, that's the topological structure. Let's talk now about belief. Yes, David, yes.
Yes, sorry, I chatted the question. We still have to figure out the proper social structures for how these things work. I'm wondering if this is where you're going to be going with this. And if I take random walks through these kinds of networks, they might get very long, but you're going to get much less than exponential compounding of error rates because you keep revisiting the same node. So mm-hmm. if we're really sure of that node, then it's going to be really help us avoid the error catastrophe.
You know, I would say prediction is not explanation, and your prediction of where, of what the next slide is going to be is, I would say, you know, I'm going to give you 70% accuracy on that. but well done, David, absolutely.
So that's cool.
Here you go, right? So what we want to do is build a model that is as close as possible to the logical justification model. What we're going to do here is assume that the truth of one claim is perceived by the mathematician. So, you know, how cognitively plausible that is at the Koch level, I don't know. We're going to assume that that claim has influence over the things that depend upon it. So what we're doing essentially is trying to take the linear chain model of mathematical reasoning and stick in the directed acyclic graph. This gets you pretty far along to certainty. So we know that there's no phase transition in one dimension, but that we can maybe get a little further if the topology of how things are connected to each other gets more complex. I won't go into detail on that model just because those who know the Ising model already know it. Those who don't are not going to figure it out now. Maybe the sort of way to justify it as opposed to explain it is to say that it's the simplest possible model that makes the truth of something on a network depend or be independent of the rest of the network, conditional upon the nodes that connect to it. So should I believe this? Well, whether or not I believe this should depend only upon, in this simple version, only upon the things that are said to establish its truth. If I fix the truth or falsehood here, the truth of this should now be independent of the rest of the stuff in the graph. Now, that doesn't mean that this is decorrelated with the rest of the graph. It means that if you fix this stuff, okay, it decorrelates. But of course, you don't fix this stuff, everything is fluctuating together. So, you know, if you think about the way the sort of formal model of how this works in the one-dimensional case, it's the telephone game. You know, depending upon the coupling of one node to another, meaning depending upon the extent to which the you think you're able to avoid a mistake in conducting a derivation. So I guess I did this for my undergrads, but as you crank down the temperature, meaning as you crank up your faith in your ability to reason logically, you can get longer and longer runs of getting things right. But in one dimension, you're always going to blow it. At some point, somebody is going to interfere with that chain. It's the telephone game, and the telephone game goes wrong. But it is possible to have the to have a percolation of truth across the entire network at a cognitively plausible level of error rate if the network has the right structure. So this is an argument that I stole from Eugene Stanley. Murray tells me that that was stolen from somewhere else. But if you think about the way in which two nodes might couple to each other, the linear chain is that as you get further and further away from that node, the influence of this, your faith in this, becomes less and less relevant because you probably made a mistake. Any particular chain will decay exponentially like that. So the influence of, you know, one belief on a belief further down the chain decays exponentially, but the number of pathways for that influence to travel on could also increase exponentially. So each path becomes less and less important, right? But the number of paths as you get further and further away blows up exponentially. You have two exponentials. When they cancel precisely, you get all the beautiful power law stuff sitting in the middle. We actually don't particularly care about the critical point. We care about what happens beyond that. If that influence is strong enough, if P is large enough, in other words, then the decay can be arrested by the increase in the number of paths. So there's one thing, so a couple of things, great. Chris says, under no circumstances credit this past influence argument to Gene Stanley. All right, I consider it done. David says, are you talking about multiple different proofs of the same theorem? No. Hi, Sid, yes, okay. SFI has voted in the chat on this. Sorry, Murray was right, as always. David says, are we talking about multiple different proofs of the same theorem? So no, great question. We're already getting beyond the pure philosophical justification of mathematics. We're saying that this chain here, if this chain works, then this chain doesn't necessarily have to work. So in that tree network, or sorry, in that directed acyclic graph I showed you, still, if you're a good mathematician, every single link has to work, right? So if this thing depends on this and this, this better be true and this better be true. It doesn't solve your error catastrophe there. But what we're saying now is that we're going to allow this thing here to be influenced by this thing here along paths separately. So there's not a synergistic need. We played around a little bit looking at, say, okay, look, if this has multiple inputs, maybe these all have to be true, or there should be some kind of and-like function, some soft and. It doesn't make much difference on the conclusion. So these are the deductive pathways. Any node has multiple paths between them. You probably guess what's coming. This network does indeed have the kind of structure you want, such that you get this non-Eugene Stanley exponential balancing. What's happening here is that you don't just have the chain, but you have multiple chains flowing and merging and splitting as the proof goes on. That's not enough, unfortunately. And the reason that's not enough is because of the directed acyclic nature of the network, it can only propagate in one direction. So you get some of these paths kicking in, but the paths can't go the other direction. So you become, in other words, dependent upon axioms. If the axioms are false, or if things early down in that story are false, nothing further up can help you. Now, I would say, and I think maybe James would agree with me on this, that that's not how mathematicians work. They also use, and so, okay, dig into all the sort of fun pragmatist philosophy mathematics you want. There is also the abductive pathway. So abduction, this is Peirce. Abduction is not induction. It's certainly not deduction. It's what could be true to make what I know or believe true. I find Peirce's account of abduction kind of hard to grasp. I think he's writing before we all became Bayesians, at least temporarily. So I often have trouble keeping induction and abduction apart if I just read Peirce. However, there is a great book called The Sign of Three, which was given to me by, I think, one of the trustees years ago. This is edited by Umberto Eco, so it's got to be good, and also by Thomas Sebiok, who edited or was involved in the first papers at Indiana. The Sign of Three is, you can see from the subtitle, Dupin, Holmes, Peirce. It's an analysis, essentially, it's mostly an analysis of Sherlock Holmes stories from a Peircean point of view. If you want to know what abduction is, it's what Holmes does all the time, right? Watson is stuck in the deductive or inductive frame. Holmes is the kind of person who sits there and says, all right, you know, here are all the facts we know in the case. I'm going to leap backwards to explain them on the, I leap backwards to discover the thing that ought to be true to make this true. Mathematicians do that. Here's an example. This is Principia Mathematica. So this is where type theory was invented. Page 379 of the Principia proves that 1 plus 1 equals 2. So why on earth would you do that? It's not because you worry that 1 plus 1 is not equal to 2. If they had failed to prove that 1 plus 1 equals 2, or if they proved it equal 3, we would not all of a sudden, you know, shut down our elementary schools. We would instead figure that they had made a mistake earlier in their proof. Something had gone wrong for their proof. So Principia, this is an example, I would say, of abductive reasoning. Penelope Maddie has a great article called Believing the Axioms, which digs into this. I do not have the mathematical background to read it well, but this is a great example of mathematicians reasoning backwards to increase their confidence. So all you do is take your Ising model, instead of it being directed, instead of the JIJs being asymmetric, you make them symmetric. Now, all of a sudden, you really do, in fact, get a phase transition. It's a soft one. I hope people heard me. Sid didn't hear me for a while, but if you didn't hear me, it's true. Once you allow for abduction, you get your phase transition. Don't kill me. It's not the world's sharpest phase transition. It's not as sharp as you would get, like if this were a lattice, but then mathematicians don't reason on a lattice. There are other constraints here. I would say one of the big constraints on these networks is the assembly mechanism, how proofs get put together, which James brought up. The assembly mechanism, it's cognitively plausible. It fits, you know, Sid's model. It matches what Ricard and Sergey find, Sergey and Ricard find. All those things fit together.
Simon, question.
Yes, Melanie. Yes, sorry.
So, sorry, I'm confused. So you say once you allow for abduction, I missed something there. What is it that you're allowing now with respect to your
thank you,
network construction?
So deduction, we stick an Ising model, but it's asymmetric, meaning the degree of belief in this node depends on the things, on your degree of belief of the things that support it, along with your with the degree at which you believe you can correctly go from this to this, right? So the deductive thing is running this model on a directed acyclic graph. The abduction step now allows the truth of this to impact the truth of these. So pure deduction, these are independent of this, right? Abduction allows that backwards pathway to work as well. So here's some examples. On the x-axis, you have the inference error rate. Now we have Poincaré levels of screw up, like 10% of the time you screw up. Even if you're like really crappy, you can get like 99% belief in Euclid's geometry, even if you believe that your, you know, sort of step-by-step error rate is 10%. So we should probably go like video when they teach at St. John's and see how many times the tutor screws up the reasoning. You can still believe things. Yes, David Kinney asked, does the line for abduction switch you to an undirected graph? Exactly. You can get degrees of certainty that exceed the inference error rate, or at least get very close to it in some cases. So I got Euclid's geometry, the reals are uncountable in the four color theorem there. Solid dotted and dashed lines are average degree of belief, degree of belief in the final theorem, and degree of belief in the axioms. So now the axioms also are influenced by the rest of the network. You start believing the axioms more because abduction says, well, you believe the conclusion right now. So, you know, maybe you should also think that those axioms weren't crazy. Final thing that I'll talk about here, we have a little bit of time and then we'll end at 1:15 Santa Fe time, is we were playing around with this. It's a natural thing to do is, okay, you switched on abduction. These ones here make the deductive and abductive pathways equally strong. So fine, now allow the matrix to be asymmetric, meaning allow the influence of this on the things that it requires to be greater or less than this on the things that it establishes. So allow this to be asymmetric now again. We played around with that and we discovered what we'll call this the abductive paradox. So this is lovely. So these are contraplots. On the x-axis is your deductive error rate, so the extent to which you think you can correctly deduce things logically. Y-axis is your abductive error rate, the extent to which you think you're Sherlock Holmes, right? Notice that these contours are degrees of certainty. As you go to the upper right-hand corner, you get more and more certain. That's your phase transition kicking in. First thing, by the way, so if you have no abduction, doesn't work. You can see all the contours cross the x-axis. Same if you have no deductive power, abduction's not enough. But notice that let's say you fix your deductive error rate and increase your abductive error rate. Let's say you fix your deductive error rate and decrease your abductive error rate. So going up here means you're better and better at abduction. You have greater and greater confidence in abduction. At first that helps you, right? You're like, you know, basically increasing abduction power, decreasing your error rate in abduction is like, wow, I've got great intuition. Like I see the forms, right? The problem is that if your abduction gets too strong, it can cut off your deduction, right? So if the abduction, this pathway gets too strong relative to this pathway, it completely overloads any propagation upwards. So now, even though you've switched on both pathways, one of them is too strong, it cuts off the other one. So a good mathematician doesn't have overconfidence in abduction any more than she has overconfidence in deduction. One way to think about the abductive paradox is if your abduction is too strong, you say things like this, that's crazy. Like that theorem is so nuts, I don't believe it. Like you must have made a mistake. I don't care. Yeah, great. Look at all that great deductive stuff. I'm sure you made a mistake. Here would be a case where your abductive paradox kicks in. If your abduction is too strong, you will never believe the Banach-Tarski theorem, which says you can cut an orange into five pieces and reassemble it and get two oranges. Right?
Simon, I'm trying to understand what you mean by abduction is too strong. Does that mean looking too hard for things that you wish were true because if they were, you could prove the thing you're trying to prove? Is that, because I thought that's what abduction was.
Abduction is, okay, I believe this thing here, right? Therefore, the stuff that needed to be true for this to be true is more likely to be true.
But so, Simon, I'm confused about this. Deduction, modulo issues of error rate, deduction is definite. If A, then B, modus ponens, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. Abduction, I've always thought of it, and I think it's consistent with what you're saying, it's maximum likelihood. I'm trying to find the parameters, the preceding axioms that make my data to be more true. So I'm trying to find that which causes what I know to be true to be more true. But that's only a probabilistic thing. Abduction is not like deduction in that it's not ironclad. So yep. I'm missing something there.
No, you're not. I would say you're right. Abduction is probabilistic. I would disagree, you know, slightly with your how you cash out abduction, but that's all right, punt that. It's great enough. You know, our move here is to make deduction also probabilistic. And it's probabilistic because of error. So, you know, if I were to try to convince a mathematician of this, I'd say, look, you know, abduction, it can fail, right? And it can fail because it, you know, it doesn't have an underlying deductive justification, okay? Flip side is, I would say, deduction, as it is practiced, like actually existing deduction, right, is also probabilistic, right? Andrew Wiles made some mistakes. And yet, you know, that guy spent, you know, decades proving that thing. So I would say, and maybe David, the right way to say this is, I don't want to, like, this is not a normative talk. It's not a talk about why we ought to believe proofs. It's more a talk about the pathways that we need to put into place such that we can get the degrees of belief and proof that we want.
This is Artemy.
Artemy, do you have a thing?
Yeah, okay. I mean,
I
think I see.
Okay.
I think
there's some very quiet speaking.
Can't hear you.
Artemy, you can if you like type in the chat, then I can see you.
Does this work better? Is this work better?
Oh yeah, hey, what's up?
Okay, sorry about that. I actually am not very sure what you mean by abduction, or at least you know I am not very familiar with mathematicians sort of reasoning from the thing they just proved to the assumptions they made to prove it.
Yep.
Now,
yep.
But I think there is a very interesting mode where there's something we kind of want to deduce, and we say, we don't necessarily ask, are the axioms true or false? Because, you know, axioms are always true. We say, you know, what axioms should we choose to lead us to this? So like one example I'm thinking of is something like Shannon entropy, which was, you know, invented by mm-hmm. von Neumann and then invented yep. by Claude Shannon. And then I believe Kinchin came up and said, oh, look, here's a bunch of axioms that make this the unique measure of uncertainty. Right. And then other people came up with a bunch of other ones. And yep. so it's a little bit, I think, I guess to me, it seems kind of different. It's not necessarily going back one step. It's sort of like looking for the very foundation of the whole graph. And I'm wondering if those are compatible or if there is also another mode where you sort of go back one step, or how are you thinking about this?
Let me jump in here, Artemy, and I'll give you two examples. One is my introspection. The other is I have a quote. My last slide just coming in a mo is a quote from a mathematician, which you know, and we'll talk a little bit about that. So here's my example of abduction and action, which is it's very meta, right? It is this plot, right? So I'm sitting in the cafe. I run this stuff. I see the contours turn over. I'm like, Christ, right? I've made a mistake in my code. Like, I hate my life. So I go back into the code and I'm like tearing it apart. I'm like, where's the mistake? And, you know, then I have a cup of coffee and I think, wait a second. It actually makes sense that these curves turn over. Now, here's what happens when I do that. All of a sudden, I become more confident in my code. My confidence in my code and sort of the underlying reasoning process that made the graph, my confidence has increased all of a sudden only because I've now increased my belief in the output. So I would say that's a pretty intuitive thing. That's something that we probably all do. I don't know, maybe I've just confessed to something that I shouldn't have confessed to. But that experience of believing the code more than because of an examination of its consequences, that's an example of abduction. Now, we have a very mechanistic model here that's, you know, icing model, arrows, things are very local. You know, I'm happy to, you know, get an RU to do all the stuff, make this synergistic, have long range. That's totally cool.
It's almost like I see what you're saying. When we come to a very weird place, like an inconsistency or something we mm-hmm. find hard to believe, we yep. go back and start double checking and start paying more. We start sort of paying more attention to how we got there. Okay.
Exactly. But not only do we do that, we also think about, you know, we also kind of think about the, let's take the contours turning over, right? If we start to find the output more and more intuitive by some other mechanism, for example, that can propagate backwards. And now we're no longer as worried about errors in the past or errors further down. So we might go check the code. But in that story I told you, I checked the code, then I had a cup of coffee. Then I felt that, in fact, that result was more intuitive. Now, all of a sudden, I've increased my confidence in the code, even though I haven't checked it again. I didn't open the code again before I increased my confidence. I'll skip just because I, you know, obviously you guys have to go cough on people. Here is a quote. I've like blurred out the person who sent me this quote, but let's just take it as a very good mathematician. I'll just read it to you. And this is, I think, what we want to do as, you know, here's my pitch for being good SFI, cultural evolution, cognitive science people here, merging these two levels. We should go back and say, does this actually match what people are doing? So I'll read this. For working mathematicians, a step-by-step logical deduction tends to be seen merely the vehicle for dragging the reader, kicking and screaming towards a gestalt shift in perspective, a switch that once you've succeeded in making it, makes the statement in question and more besides totally obvious and natural, and it couldn't have ever been otherwise. The deduction is necessary, but the gestalt switch is the point. That, I think, explains the feeling of certainty that mathematicians express. So, you know, we can do a close reading of that, you know, put Scott in a lab and scan him. I would say this is a great example of a sort of report from the field of how abduction is working. Certainly much more complicated than the model we have in play here, but, you know, well, obviously the icing model describes everything. So something has to be working for us. I noticed in the chat, lots of references to how to solve Apollonius, proofs and refutations by Lakatos. We have lots of references in the paper. It's on the Slack channel. So you can dig into some of the philosophy of mathematics. We spent a lot of time reading some really fun stuff on both sides of this debate of what is normatively justifying about mathematics. And then also how does mathematics actually happen, which I think is the frontier for both philosophy, mathematics, and this kind of, I guess, math of math that we're doing.
Question, Simon.
Question.
So it looks like that that the quote is saying that the purpose of the logical deduction is for convincing the reader or listener. That's what they're saying there, kicking and screaming, not the mathematician themselves. That the mathematician themselves is relying more on this gestalt kind of intuitive model, the logic deduction step comes later as a kind of communicative device.
Yep, I'm totally down with that, and I think that would fit the Mercier-Sperber story, right? You know, Scott, Michael asked me, can you tweet this? Don't just tweet the text that's not blurred if you like. I'm sure that's fine. The mathematician, like, you know, Scott goes and he like touches the forms or whatever he does, right? You know, he does drugs or whatever, right? He doesn't do drugs, but that's fine. So he comes to this belief, and then also lots of other stuff, right? Not just the belief, but also how you prove it, or rather the things that establish its truth. But then he's got this now social process, right? He's got this justificatory process. The proof is fundamentally justificatory. It's about convincing the listener. In the same way that, you know, you or I might form beliefs about what we ought to do in this bizarre new world. But then there's a separate thing of justifying them to each other, and the separate question of why you ought to believe my justification. So this has been sitting, I think, implicitly in CogSci, network belief networks, these kinds of things. We haven't been able to study them because those belief networks have been kind of hand-constructed intuitively. Like, so Thagard will make a belief network about the O.J. Simpson trial. The great thing about math is that those networks are much, much larger. So we get real stats out of them. We can really put a model on them and learn about it. And then once you go to the Conk level, you really have great statistics on what's going on. And very happily, they seem to match the statistics of the mathematician, you know, like Euclid back 400 BC. So there's lots of really nice pieces going together there. And I think, you know, I'm happy, Melanie, because I think you've got the point of this talk.
Simon?
Yes.
Question. So very nice, thank you. So in a way, your talk was about the robustness of proof under a certain model of stochastic logic, right?
Yes.
And which is great. And if it's true you're claiming two things, let me understand. One is the sort of multiplicity of paths and abduction are the two, in some sense, new mechanisms that would increase the robustness of proof under your assumptions, which I think is reasonable. But it's not how mathematics is taught, right? So it's taught as a deterministic science with a unique path. And I'm just wondering, are good mathematicians aware that, in your language, being abductive and understanding degeneracy would make your proof more compelling?
I think that any practicing mathematician, I would be hard pressed to find one that thinks the way we teach mathematics is good, right? I think we teach it the way we teach Latin, right? Cicero did not, you know, compose Latin sentences the way we're taught to do it. I think it's taught as a mental exercise. If you look at Proofs and Refutations, which I'm sure you've read, David, I'm sure at some point, it's great because it does it as a dialectic. It shows, in that case, they're doing the thing about vertices and edges in the polyhedron. It's shown as a dialectic that I would say matches a lot of the stuff we're doing here. Okay, like, let's go forward, see what happens. Oh, like, here's the counterexample. We ought not to believe that. Scott Viteri calls this monster barring. The way we teach mathematics is, it's certainly a form of logic and justification. I would say that's a totally separate normative thing that we do when we teach it, as opposed to when, you know, real live mathematicians go about forming these things. I'd also say that real live mathematicians go about justifying their beliefs in theorems to in very similar ways to the way you and I might go about justifying our beliefs in other kinds of claims. I certainly wouldn't, you know, if I wanted to convince you of something, David, I certainly wouldn't teach it to you like you're in elementary school. That's like the paradigm of being a dick. Instead,
it might work with me though, unfortunately.
Yes, well, look, let me just slow it down for you, David. So I think that's, I mean, I'm answering two questions there. One is, yes, mathematics education is weird, you know, bonus, this is a good, you know, another attack on that. Mathematicians would agree, and I think it also, you know, as a model for justification more generally in culture, I think this is a better story. This one generalizes better than the elementary school one.
Thanks. Thank you.
Question? Two quick questions.
Chris.
First, I think that you're sort of getting at this, but there, of course, practicing mathematicians, and for that matter, practicing human beings, use many, many different things besides just deduction and abduction in trying to prove things. And so it'd be really cool to see just somehow a more general way of integrating that, which I think is actually related to some of the things that Melanie has been saying are her interests about real cognitive reasoning. But then another more mathy question. If you give me a statement in a formal system, I can prove it, so it becomes a theorem, or I can actually disprove it, or the formal system is powerful enough, it might be, and I wouldn't even know it, but I can't do either of the above.
Yep.
So that suggests three different kinds of networks. You have, I mean, the one about proof and disproof, certainly I don't think they could be identical, because then your reasoning would say I can disprove any statement as easily as I can prove it, or I'm not sure if it does. How do those three different networks interplay with one another?
Great question, David. I would love to have a big database of proofs that don't work, but we don't have them. Sadly, we don't have them, right? We only have the successful proofs.
We have the disproofs.
But a disproof is just a disproof.
So as far as your analysis is concerned, they're the same thing, a disproof and a proof.
Yeah, now let me interject a subtlety here. The Koch, and in fact, actually Euclid does this as well. Koch enforces, it bans non-constructive proofs. So, and this is type theory in general, yeah. Type theory excludes non-constructive proofs. That leads to all sorts of fun philosophical consequences. It also, for example, makes these things, it skips around the Godel incompleteness problem, which is lovely.
Yeah.
If I want to prove something, I actually have to demonstrate the existence of an object of the type proof of that thing. If I want to prove, for example, the existence, if I want to prove that an object with a certain property exists, I have to construct an object with that property. So Koch does actually restrict you to one domain. I would also suggest, I think the larger question of like how how can we inject more realism into these stories is dead on. So I'd be totally up for that. You know, we should have a working group at some point, right? More working group needed to really think about that. You know, the stumbling block here that I have is that it's really hard to get these networks for other kinds of justification processes. I think that intuitively, this is what we do. We don't prove things mathematically, but we certainly produce change. We relate claims to each other. Getting those networks, getting those actual networks is going to be hard. I don't know, maybe James can have some NLP here to pull this stuff up. You know, maybe we can ask people to introspect. But, you know, figuring out exactly how people work with these things would be really lovely. So
it would be also interesting to see, I think somebody mentioned before, Dijkstra, which brings to mind optimal path, i.e. dynamic programming, i.e. working backwards from where you want to be to where you are now. And so it raises all kinds of questions about might the optimal way of actually proving something be the technique it is that you want to prove or disprove and start working backwards. So it's like almost like abduction on steroids or something. In addition to going forwards and just seeing if there's other stuff in the reinforcement learning literature that's related to dynamic programming that maybe is somehow relevant.
So let me just, and you're mentioning something that James has this in the chat, and then you know, we should actually finish. We'd be good about this and encourage people to chime in on Slack or send me emails, because I would love to have some more references and thoughts, and you can tear it apart, please do. James, I'll read James's quote here. Dijkstra's point was somewhat different. You follow deduction along circuitous paths that lead you someplace surprising. Then you perform the intuition through a quote unquote elegant proof, which ironically reduces intuition. What James is getting at there, I think, is the proof construction step as opposed to the proof perception step that we have. Another big thing, we don't have failed proofs in our database, sadly, right? Because no one gives them to us. We also don't have the unfolding time series of how a mathematician actually constructs this. We'd love to have that. We could have people, you could have mathematicians video themselves. Actually, we probably have the GitHubs for a lot of these proofs. We may even be able to see a little bit about how they go about it, which would be lovely. I should end here to be good. No one ever complained a seminar ended early. Thank you all very much for coming.